Morning friends, today we are going to have again another look at sedimentation, coagulation and floculation. Particularly what I feel is required to be known. So sedimentation makes particles denser, it makes them settle to the bottom of the tank, and you need to have larger and heavier particles basically. And it should be done in what is known as this quiescent conditions. What is this? Quiescent basin conditions. The flow should be should not have any turbulence. That is the basic thing, and it should be slow. Flow rate should be uniform. No dynamic mixing, nothing is there. Only at that condition, sedimentation is going to be very efficient. So this is something which you yourself know. I'll again quote the example of still water. And when a person walks on the water, automatically the particles tend to move around. Reason is a lot of energy is being supplied to the particles. Okay. And here, if you ask what is the principle Stokes' law is used, you remember Stokes' law? He took some steel balls, had a long jar, dropped it. Okay. So you just go and have a look at it. This is the fundamental of this. Okay. And this is all, this operation is done in a settling basin. And the process is called settling. Okay, the process is called settling. Now this is a sedimentation tank. Please have a look at the link given here. Normally, if a material is there which you can actually access, I will give the link. So please go and have a look at this link. It gives very good ideas about the principles, the problems, whatever we were talking about as required, they are all there. So please have a look at this link. Again, sedimentation has certain problems. What are these problems? Not all suspended materials will get removed. What suspended material will not get removed ordinarily in settling or sedimentation? Any guess?
Colloidal particles.
Colloidal particles will not settle, correct? So I still remember during rainy days, when I was smaller, we used to use the pipe water only. The water will be very colored. Okay. So my mother will keep the water for one day, then she will transfer the water which is on top, and usually they will pass it through that, you know, she will keep a sari and filter it. I am sure all of you would have seen this. Actually, this is a very fundamental principle, sedimentation and decantation and filtration. In fact, I remember studying this in 5th standard in science. These are the three terms, and this is what we are actually doing here. We are sedimenting, we are again decanting, we are just removing what is on top, then we are filtering. So please think about it in those lines. I am sure you will find it more and relevant and interesting. And detention period sometimes will have to be very long for these things to get removed, and even if you keep it for such a long time, it may not work. What happens if you are going to keep dirty water still for a long time? It will become anaerobic, it will become like sewage, that sort of condition will start to form. So it will not be very practical to keep sewage for a very long time. The detention time is the duration or period over which the sample is kept in a unit operation. Okay. Then what are the factors that affect settling rate? Buoyancy and drag force. Buoyancy, what is buoyancy? It is the upward force which is experienced by a body which is immersed in a fluid or in a liquid. Okay. And drag. If suppose something is trying to go down, the drag force will oppose it. Okay. So essentially, if you go into the swimming pool and try to push your water, even you do this in a bucket of water, keep rotating your arm in an empty bucket of water and then have some water filled in it. So you can understand what drag is. The particles try to settle, but drag force will prevent it from settling. And what about this temperature? If the temperature is higher, then the density of water is slightly lesser, and then again the viscosity will also get lower. And if it is more viscous, what happens essentially? Or if it is denser? it
tends to settle down.
It doesn't tend to settle down. It finds it difficult to settle down. Try to take
so
a particle of
viscosity is higher.
So in honey, what will happen for a ball of steel ball? Same thing, you have to extend it here also. Okay. And viscosity, I'm sure you'll understand what it does. And colloidal particles, this bacteria, color or colored material, and turbid, whatever causes turbidity will not settle. Usually clay and all these are colloidal particles, cause more turbidity than other things. Color and everything, you can just extend it. Okay, now we are going to go in for these terms, coagulation and flocculation. These help in sedimentation. Okay, so the definition which we are seeing here for coagulation is, it's a chemical process that makes sedimentation faster. It just makes sedimentation faster. So how does it do it? It is going to do it by increasing the weight of the particles, the turbid particles. Okay, and the other thing is flocculation. So flocculation is a physical process used to enhance the effectiveness of coagulation. Okay, now the working principle basically is, coagulation neutralizes charged particles. Okay, that is, coagulant neutralizes charged particles. Light charged particles repel each other. Okay, so we are trying to bring it down, and these actually keep the particles in suspension. Two particles come close to each other, it immediately repels. It will go closer to another particle, that will again repel it. So there is a very random motion which is occurring in the fluid. If I'm not mistaken, I think it's called Brownian movement. Brownian movement. This random motion of colloidal particles, I think it's called Brownian movement. You can just have a look at that. Okay. So this process is a chemical process which we adopt. Okay. And in the process of coagulation, we form what is called as flocs. So what does floc do? They enmesh and agglomerate. That means enmesh means they hold it as a mesh and become bigger particles.
So they try to attract each other.
What they do is, this is a positively charged substance. It neutralizes any negative charge. So once that happens, automatically things, or what do you say, there's a positive and a negative particle. Negative particle tends to attract and come till the charge is neutralized. Initially the coagulant will be having a very high positive charge. So one negative charge, as the density increases, negative thing charge increases, automatically two things happen. The size increases, maybe the charge, positive charge becomes lesser, but our objective is to make it come down, settle. So that objective is going to get achieved. Okay, so in the process we trap other things also. Okay, what all we trap? We trap microorganisms. Okay, a lot of viruses also get entrapped in this process. Suspended particles also get entrapped, and colloidal material also get entrapped. And for this, the pH level is very important, because at particular pH only the coagulant which you use will be effective. Okay, here are some coagulants which are used. I am not going to read it out. Okay, you can go through these in leisure, and you can also probably have a look, greater or more detailed look into this if you want. This is going to be very important for a person who is going to take up environmental engineering as his bread and butter, because he should know what should be used when. Okay, and these are just a few. So what happens? We already yesterday spoke about what is known as rapid or flash mixing. Okay, so here is the rapid or these are the steps. First is rapid or flash mixing. In this, what actually happens is the chemicals are dispersed effectively. So flocculation does take place. It doesn't actually, it's only a mixing of the chemicals. The next step, the flocculation takes place. So it's more slow mixing. In fact, this rapid mixing is only for very short period, 30 seconds to 1 minute. That's the only thing they want that thing. But here, the slow mix is usually they say at a 1 RPM, one rotation per minute, only they expect the paddle to go. And it keeps the liquor in motion. If it is not in motion, what happens? There's no chance for thing to meet. Okay. What I'll say, it just one analogy will be in some countries, especially they don't, their boys and girls don't get a chance to meet. They don't have arranged marriage system. So what they have public dance. They are asked to go and dance in the middle with each other and see if they like each other. So this is what happens. If you're not giving that opportunity, all the flock coagulants are going to be where they are. Now we are giving them a chance to meet and mix with each other. And we don't do it very fast because we don't want them to break also. So then after this, it will move on to the settling basin. Essentially what we saw in the first part, the sedimentation tank what I was talking about, it will be done. And what are the things which we use? We use polymers, activated silica and adsorbent weighing agents and some oxidants to increase the weight. Okay, for instance, this third one, adsorbent, that is what this adsorbent does. It's nothing but something that will add weight to the...
So these are in addition to the...
Yes, coagulants. Okay, this is to make the coagulation process more effective. Okay, in fact, you can also add the zeta potential here. When you have, all these will enhance the coagulation process. This adsorbent, what it does, it is essentially like, if suppose you are going to tie a heavy stone around your leg and get into water, what happens? You are going to be weighed down. So this is what it does. It absorbs is a surface phenomenon, it absorbs the things and weighs it down. So these are all, what is adsorbent is, those are all chemical terms which I am not going to talk about. But if you are interested, you can have a look at it. Okay, so and next thing is, we are again, I'm just going back to the rapid mix. Excuse me, just turn off my mobile edit. Yeah. So what happens in rapid mix? First, coagulants are added. There's violent agitation. So rapid mix essentially is violent agitation. It's just very short time, matter of minutes they do it. And what are the factors that affect it? pH, temperature and ionic strength. Okay, what is this ionic strength? The charge of the coagulant, what you add, how it is. Okay, if it is very less charge, you are not going to get the efficiency. And then how do you determine the contact period? Contact period is determined by your jar test. Okay. Right. So, what are the methods that are used for rapid mix? Now the thing is, till now we only saw rapid mix. In most of the books, there is only one paragraph of rapid mix. Okay, I just want to widen your perception a little. These are the techniques which are used. It looks frightening, huh? So many numbers, but it's very simple. Okay, so these are things which are actually being done in the field. So we have mechanical agitators, what you have normally in your textbook. Something goes to the paddle, mixes it and that's it. Other thing is, you can, inside a centrifugal pump, you can imagine how much of turbulence is there. That will cause the mixing to take place. Next is baffles. Baffles is nothing but obstructions placed in the path of water. So it has to move more and automatically there is going to be mixing. This hydraulic jump is a phenomena which takes place in water. And partial flume is a measuring, actually it's a flow measuring device. You can actually achieve two things. You can mix your coagulant and also measure the fluid rate. And the third thing is inline mixers. These three are probably better explained by these videos. So here we go. Let me just increase the volume. I think it might be less. Yes, it is less. So here we go. All right. Yes, there is an outlet. There is a discharge tank at this area. In this area, can you see there is a discharge tank? Exactly what you have in your fluid mechanics lab. It's a collection tank. Okay? Okay. What is the thing you observed here?
Normal flow of water, when you obstruct it and when you control the inflow.
Okay, wait, I will explain what a hydraulic jump is. There is a liquid which is going at a very high velocity. Suddenly it is encountering a region of low velocity. Then what happened? There was a very great increase in the height. So this is called hydraulic jump. Okay, now what happened? Actually, flows just, there was a high velocity flow, nothing was obstructing it. Then what happened? He dropped a baffle, okay, an obstruction. When the obstruction was dropped, immediately water velocity is zero here. So slowly the hydraulic jump, there was a hydraulic jump which we saw, still it reached a steady state condition. Okay, now what else did you see? Initially the height was large, okay, A into V, whatever you use is that. Then what happened? A is made very, very small. So V increases greatly. Continuity equation. Okay, so that is why the velocity is very, very large, height was very less. Okay, now did you notice he added some marbles? What happened to the marbles after the hydraulic jump? It was going in a, trace the same path. Okay, it was just going in the same line. Now I'm going to ask you one more thing. What is this Reynolds experiment? You would have done that in fluid mechanics. You would have taken a, you had a tank, you had some dye, you introduced the dye into the fluid, and then what did you do? You adjusted the flow rate. Okay, in what condition was the dye uniform? What did you call that?
Reynolds number is zero.
Sorry? Reynolds number is not zero, it is less than 2000, but that is called laminar flow. Yes, how we see the flow regimes basically. So laminar, then you had transitional and turbulent. There's another flow regime called critical flow or supercritical, all that is there. So where the mixing is very, very large. In this hydraulic jump, what happens essentially is you are having a supercritical flow before the hydraulic jump. But after the hydraulic jump, you have in fact almost steady state flow. Now, please apply this to your coagulation process, water, sedimentation and all this. What did you want? You basically want quiescent conditions so that settling actually takes place. And in when you add the coagulant, you want rapid mixing. After rapid mixing, what happens? What do you want? You need slow mixing. Almost, can you see the process happening here? Okay? So, flock formation can be increased like that, or you can take this and discharge it into another tank where you can actually have a flock later. Okay? So, are you able to relate this to your thing? Like we are saying rapid mixing can be done by the use of a hydraulic jump. Okay. Now I'll just go to the next slide. This is a video of the partial flume. It's not too much, but please remember this is a metering device also. Partial flume is basically a metering device. Okay, what did you observe here?
All the particles have to come together at the middle portion.
Mm.
So then, little bit of mixing takes place.
No, see, the syrup profile, now you go back and review the video, yes, correct. So there's a contraction and then much like your venturimeter, right? So that's, when it goes out, what happens? Lot of turbulence is there. So what you can do, you can measure the fluid using the partial flume. Just as the fluid is exiting, you can add your coagulant. And can you see the amount of turbulence which is there? Definitely a lot of mixing can.
Is there a height difference?
It is just turbulence, just turbulence. Okay, that white water effect, you call that. Okay, you can have a look at it in either YouTube or YouTube has lovely videos. Okay, and very frankly speaking, I really wish that our students will do this sort of videos by themselves, because today mobile phones are there and a lot of free video editing tools are there, and it's marvelous. Like, you know, when you are doing, when you're looking at 4 or 5 videos and then you want to make a video which is better than the others, you have to put in a little research and you learn much more. Anyway, we'll see how it goes. Now, this is a inline jet rapid mixer. Okay, see these points over here. Okay, please have a look at these. Please, yeah. So this is where you inject the coagulant chemicals. So the jet is here, flows in the opposite direction. Then there will be a mixing of the coagulant. It's almost like your rapid or flash mixing. Quickly, very quickly it all happens, right? Now we go in for the problems in coagulation. These are some problems which you face in coagulation. You want it to settle fast, and then you might find that your coagulant might not have the required ionic strength, and you might find that the flocs are breaking up. If the flock is not of a particular size, it cannot sediment, cannot undergo sedimentation. So these are some problems. Then these are the steps which you can use to improve the process of coagulation. Okay, coagulation essentially is the flock forming process. So you have to ensure that the dosage is correct. Okay, chemical, adding too much of chemicals also is a problem. Okay, so then these are things which you saw. And please remember one of the first few videos where they used a clay for coagulation. Almost immediately you find that the turbidity reduces. It was so fast. So I was, even I was wondering whether they are doing some trick, you know, like where you speed up that area alone. But actually that is the actual thing that happens. And one more thing is coagulation, we may need to have 2 units. This is a recommendation. The 2 units are used so that if one can be taken off stream, it will still work out. Okay. Now we go for the floculation process. It's nothing but clumping of the small colloidal particles coming into a bunch. Okay. So the floculation process encourages colloids to come in contact with each other and agglomerate. Okay. It speeds up the settling and chemical precipitation. Precipitation is just coming and settling at the bottom. Okay. So these are what affect the flock formation. This is what affects the flock formation. Amount of flocks present. If amount of flocks is more, what happens?
Everyone will be fighting.
But it will be faster. Basically, it's faster. If the volume of flocks is more, again settling is going to be faster. And basin velocity gradient. What is this basin velocity gradient? It is all happening in a large tank or basin. So velocity gradient means there is a change from the starting point to ending point. So if suppose the velocity gradient is right, you will find that the floculation is actually, the floculation as well as sedimentation, everything is taking place. Otherwise, it will not happen. You might find that it's too fast or too slow. In both cases, it's not going to help. Okay. Now sedimentation is the physical process of separating the settleable solids from the fluid using gravity. Basically here only gravity is being used. In the other flock, coagulation, what did we use? We used coagulants, some chemicals. We enhanced it by modifying the condition in which the coagulation took place. Floculation, basically it was because of making the flocks come in contact with each other. Okay, so settling will remove these things. It will remove the particulate matter, it will remove chemical flocks, it will also remove the precipitates in suspension. Okay, some precipitate will still be in the liquid, but when you sediment, it will bring it all down. Okay, there you are using surface phenomena, you are using some chemical properties. Here what we are using, we are only going to use gravity. So that's a big difference between the previous process, coagulation and flocculation and sedimentation. Now sedimentation is enhanced by the process of coagulation and flocculation. Okay, so settling tanks are used for sedimentation. They can be circular or they can be rectangular. This is a photograph of a circular settling tank. We saw a lot of videos on this. So, and also you can't see much because the rate at which the thing on top moves is very slow. The thing on top is a scum removal system. Some scum will be on the top, some lather, something will all be at the top. So that is skimmed off.
So the top is covered?
No, it's open. It's open as water. Okay. So you can actually see the construction. There is a step ladder here. You can walk along the side and a liquid will get, will overflow and collect on the side. Okay. So here is a cross section of it. Okay. So this is the area which I am talking about, where there is an overflow and it all collects in the channel. Okay. And inflows from the bottom. So then it travels. Okay, the water, essentially the liquor, travels from the side to the center to the side. Okay, and it starts to slowly settle down. Okay, so this is called the scum baffle, and this is the place where the clear liquid is taken out. Okay. Now, next thing is cross section of the weir, overflow weir. Okay, that is from the thing. It actually happens to have this profile. Okay, I have taken it from a different thing, but this kind of illustrates my point. Okay. Any problem, Nikhil? Okay. Right. So in these are rectangular tanks. That was a circular tank which we saw. So whatever we see here are baffles. Okay. And the water will flow from the center and move on to the side. If it is more squarish, they'll try to do it in they'll try to have it from the center and move to the, like, just like your circular tank. Okay. And there will be a radial flow. Usually we call it as a radial flow. So these are some of the design parameters which will be considered. Okay. So what are the design parameters? Overflow rate. Okay, that is rate at which it actually overflows and goes out. And weir loading means how much you are loading the system. Actually, it should be, both should be equal. But there is also something where the sludge is removed. So it is basically one of weir process design. Okay, which I'm not going to talk too much. And detention time. So how long you are going to keep the fluid in the tank? If it's a long detention time, you will have to have a very long, big tanks. Yes, and if suppose it's a rectangular tank, you should know the horizontal flow velocities. Okay, so these are some of the key points. So sedimentation balances time efficiency and removal rate. Okay, so removal rate is much higher when you are using sedimentation tanks, and it is going to remove material which is too small for initial screening. Initial screening might not take everything, and if suppose we are going to look at it, its efficiency is increased by coagulation and flocculation. Okay, and filtration will be the next step. Okay, in filtration we will have sand filters, then membrane filters. For instance, yesterday we had a brief look at a sand filter. Okay, and we also saw membrane filters in the videos. Okay, so basically this covers the key or important processes in our water treatment, drinking water treatment. The same thing, okay, I don't mind having this done because this is the same principle which is going to be extended for your sewage treatment also. Sewage treatment will also have all these processes done depending on the effluent requirement. It's from the sewage treatment plant what goes out, they will have a standard. Okay, because suppose you are going to mix it, mix the sewage into a very large body of water, the dilution is so high that you can afford to have some, what should I say, the standard of treatment can be little less low. But if you want it to be very, very good, people can also do it. It's costly, so all these things are offset. So in all these things, you would have seen, I tried my best to give you the fundamental principle, how it works, what goes in, and then what are the things that affect the treatment. Okay, whatever is the thing which is going to affect the thing, and also the end result. Okay, like for example, I have not given you the values, like so much of particles are going to be removed, or this is the period over which it is going to be done. Now, why did I not do that? Because all these are parameters which will be determined by the plant requirement. Okay, like we are talking, detention period can be only 1 hour, but it can be also 10 hours. Same thing, what about this mixing? The mixing is what is more important. Okay, but the process might mean that if it's going through a hydraulic jump, the process will be very short. Might not, it will be maybe the order of a few seconds itself probably. Or if you're going to use a paddle, it might be slightly more. So because of this reason, I'm not putting emphasis on the length of time or how much of concentration it's reducing and all these parameters. Okay, but for your information, you just have a look at all of this, like what is desirable and all this, and please ensure that you try to apply it. Okay, so definitely all of this are application
oriented. Can you choose between a circular tank and a rectangular?
It is purely process requirement. See what happens in that rectangular tank. Saw the amount of area which is required. So suppose a country has that space. Usually many of the foreign countries like America, Australia, they are not very populated. So they can actually afford to have longer tanks. They
so
have the land.
More area, you go for a rectangular.
Yes. These are all process, it's all just process requirement. Okay. But many of them will have other problems also, like so much of areas to be monitored and anything can happen between. So you will be only deciding this based on your requirement, okay?